France. Not from France, but works in France. So. And he would tell us about topological excitations in ferroelectric nanostructures, negative capacitance, multi-layer logic, and terahertz vibrations.
Okay, thank you very much. And actually, I should, in principle, send to organizers, but it is not the case. So I will thank to everybody to come to this meeting. And I will give several theoretical input of some experiments that are discussed during this workshop related with domains, vortices, and so on. So, but it's really very interesting. So Yefim told that he's prehistorical time, but sometimes I feel also myself, because 15 years ago, the people do not believe in the regular periodic structure in ferroelectric at all. And even they do not believe that ferroelectricity can exist at nanoscale. And the origin has some historical history, because it's very famous work of Butler and Silverman that were working in IBM, and in 72, they told that below certain critical thickness, the ferroelectric polar state is unstable. And so they estimated this even at some kind of submicron size. And after this, IBM stopped all work on ferroelectric memory, and I think the interest to nanoscale ferroelectricity was lost till the year 2000s. Possibly because of this, there is some delay between magnetic and ferroelectric system. But actually, this work shows how we can you can believe to us, to a theoretician. So, of course, for certain theoretician, you can believe. And because actually the answer was known already many years before it, and it was done by Landau-Lifshitz in 35. So they already considered this problem related with the polarization fields that I will talk about. And after it was also redescribed by Kittel in 46. And they show that in principle the system at small scale, the ferroelectric system should split on the domain, but it seems Butler and Silverman did not know this, and this was successfully forgotten till our days. So the origin of many phenomena that are discussed during this conference is so-called depolarization field. So indeed, if you take just some ferroelectric slab, we have some polarization, and at termination of the polarization at the surfaces, we shall have so-called depolarization surface charges, just because of the electrostatic equations, because of the boundary conditions at the surface. But these surface charges, they act like capacitor, and they create the depolarization field, which will be counter-directed to polarization. This depolarization field costs a lot of energy. And in principle, according to Batra Silverman et al., it's very simple calculations, this energy will be much higher than condensation energy of polarization. So in principle, it should kill ferroelectric. So there is no problem for the macroscopic samples, because you always have some charges that come from space and that are located at the surface, and they screen this depolarization field. But when we go to nanoscale, this problem is posed. And actually, what was proposed by Lifshitz, Landau-Lifshitz and Kittel, that the system become unstable towards splitting of the periodic domain structure. And you see in this case the depolarization field. Now, because you have the alternation of the charge at the surface, it is confined near the surface. So it is not anymore the volume contribution, mostly the surface contribution. So the bed energy is drastically diminished. But as a price to pay, we should create the domain walls for this. But all in all, but when we do some calculations, we finally find that down to nanoscale, the system become stay stable. Actually, this was several work, and one of this work in our work in 2005, where we actually calculated the critical temperature of such state for superlattices. Superlattices is even better, because in this case, we have no this influence of some external charges. And actually we calculated the critical temperature, and our result was summarized in the possibly here in this phase diagram. So when we go down to the nanoscale film, actually you should not pay too much attention, it's just order of magnitude, because at the time we did not know the realistic parameters. But anyway, when we go to very thin film, we have domain state, and the critical temperature, it reduces, but not too much. And up to 10 nanometers, at least at that time, we thought, we can still have the ferroelectricity, but in the form of the domains. What happens later, we didn't know, and now, fortunately, we have the atomistic simulations, because for very thin films, the Landau approach is not work so well, but now we know perfectly that several unit cells still we have ferroelectricity. But another important thing that was discussed actually at that time is so-called softening of domain structure, because actually when the people thought about the domains, they think that we have the periodicity of the very sharp domain wall. And actually what happens if you consider the real situation with solution of Ginzburg-Landau equation coupled with electrostatic, the domain walls, polarization in domains becomes softer. It means that we have like mostly like incommensurate phase which appear near TC, so we have double sinus profile of the polarization, and it double sinus profile in both directions, so the polarization goes to zero. I will comment on this a little bit later at the surface. And also, it is periodical sinus as a function of x. And what is important, you see this phase diagram scales as function of thickness. So at very thin films, actually, we should have really mostly soft domains that these are hard domains. Actually, after the development of experiments, there were several experiments. One was, for instance, from Pavlo, they show that by X-ray diffraction, that Pavlo told a lot about this, that this periodic domain structure, they do exist. And this was really very good discovering, and it shows that ferroelectricity can exist down to the nanoscale. Now more sophisticated methods permit to visualize this domain structure, and even later it will be talked of Ramesh, now the people really goes to the very, very finite features of this domain structure and see that actually it looks like some kind of vortices. So it will be very wonderful talk afternoon of Ramesh. He will explain more, I guess, more in detail this stuff. But let's now go to this story of the soft domains. So soft domains are different, as I told, with respect to, I call it hard or Kittel domain. Because in soft domains, the polarization varies gradually, and in hard-Kittel domains, we have sharp polarization changes at domain walls, very thin domain walls of the, I don't know, one nanometer or less. And also in the classical Kittel picture, the polarization terminates abruptly at the surface, so all of the depolarization charges are concentrated at the surface. And in the case of the soft domains, that actually the solution of the equation close to critical temperature, also polarization goes to zero at the surfaces. So it looks like this, but not the abrupt change. So, page down. Actually, this is not just solution of equation, but it has very deep physical meaning, because this story was also studied in the meantime by Lifshitz, by Landau and Lifshitz. And actually, the interesting question appeared was as follows. So, okay, so they introduced this so-called periodic Kittel domain structure with sharp, with abrupt termination of polarization. But if in this case we calculate the depolarization field that appears at the surface, we find that this depolarization field will be higher than the coercivity field. In this case, in principle, polarization should be switched at the surface. And repeating this procedure again and again, they predicted that in principle, for the hard domain Kittel structure, we should have the fractal texture of domains close to the surface. But again, this mostly was done for the magnetic system, and this was indeed observed. And in magnetic systems, the amplitude of magnetization is almost constant. But in ferroelectrics, it can vary in the amplitude, and the calculation shows that it is more advantageous not to formate this fractal-like structure as a surface, which would be possible in the case really with very thin domain walls, but exactly just to diminish the value of polarization at the surface. In this case, the depolarization charge is not concentrated anymore at the surface, but it propagates inside of the samples, and actually depolarization charge also somehow distributed within this soft domain structure. What is interesting, there's depolarization charge because it introduces electric field, and in the classical Kittel picture, electric field was, as I told, mostly confined nearby the surface, but here, because of the penetration of the depolarization charge inside of the sample, the depolarization field is also distributed inside of the sample. But this is exact solution of the Ginzburg-Landau equation coupled with the electrostatic equation. Now there is a very interesting thing, because very soon also the ab initio people start to simulate this, and because the situation is unstable with creation of domain, so if you are doing ab initio, immediately you should obtain the domains that was done. But there is some, I don't know how it's called, confusion, because actually what is calculated in theory is that we calculate polarization, distribution of polarization, and polarization is known as the spontaneous polarization, which also can be somehow distributed, plus if the electric field appears, we shall have also the induced part of the polarization. So in all of the theory, we are calculating this value, the spontaneous polarization, because this contribution, so this is p-induced, it's automatically included in the electrostatic equation through the coefficient epsilon. But what is done in the standard program of ab initio, the people see this value. So and sometimes this gives some mismatch, if not I understand from the beginning, mismatch between the result. But there is no mismatch because the theory calculate the spontaneous contribution and all of the method, ab initio, and also all of the experimental method of measurements of local polarization give us this polarization. So, and what I show here, I show the spontaneous distribution of polarization. Now, in principle, we should add this contribution because we know the distribution of electric field. And what we have? We have perfect so-called vortex structure. So there seems some confusion between domains and vortices. For me, this is the same thing. Now, it would be really very interesting, and I'm speaking now with people who are doing, well, also who are doing the experiment and who is doing the mostly ab initio, because all of the data are known from there, because if we have this one, we also know the distribution of electric field. From this, we can find the distribution of spontaneous polarization. So it would be interesting to extract this value. And after to see either we shall have really the soft domain, or possibly P0 will have also vortex-like structure, which is not excluded because we have some softening in the AB direction. And in this case, I think it will be more appropriate to discuss whether we have vortices or we have the soft domain. So it would be nice because there are now a lot of data to extract from this and to see if we have such simple structure or if we shall have some vortex-like distribution. But what is interesting and what also appears as effect after some calculations, so this structure has so-called negative capacitance effect. Now it looks like very strange because everybody knows that negative capacitance contradicts to the energy conservation. And indeed, the energy of capacitance is Q square over Tc, so it seems like impossible. The system will explode. But if you consider a little bit more sophisticated structure with two capacitors in series, one is positive and negative, total capacitance will be positive. So in principle, if we have the negative capacitance in the circuit, it will not contradict and the energy conservation law because the total capacitance will be positive. Actually, this is now there is some really boom related with this stuff because the people are talking that if we put two capacitors in series and one is negative, in this case you shall have some kind of passive voltage. And actually, I will be happy to discuss this because this is really very large story. There are a lot of publications now in high profile magazines about this. There are a lot of discussions. But anyway, that was shown that such system with domains obeys the negative capacitance. So this was our initial prediction that this is the dependence of the dielectric constant of the internal paraelectric layer. And actually, it goes to zero, but it's not goes according to Curie law, but it goes even lower. And in principle, epsilon of the ferroelectric layer becomes negative. This was confirmed by a recent experiment of Pavlo, who actually find the region of existence of negative capacitance. But I would like just to tell, just to stress that what we have the situation with the ferroelectric layer, paraelectric layer, and paraelectric layer. So actually, we have three in series capacitance, and Cf is negative and Cp is positive. And one cannot have only Cf because if you put electrode on Cf, the domains will disappear. So what was done by Pavlo, he just extracted from the whole capacitance the paraelectric capacitor and indeed find this negative capacitance behavior. Also, numerical simulation of Horke by ab initio also, they completely confirm the region of existence of negative capacitance. But let me go mostly to the physical principle. Why it is negative? Let us consider the cell of a paraelectric, ferroelectric layer. So we have the Kittel domain structure inside. And let's apply some electric field to this system. So this electric field is better to parameterize as a displacement vector d. Why displacement? Just because d is conserved through the whole system. And so we shall see the response on the system on the applied electric field d. What will happen? Actually, d will, of course, polarize the internal polarization inside of the domain. They will defavor the polarization which has the opposite direction. But in addition, it will lead to the motion of the domain walls. So domain walls with a correct direction of polarization that is along to D, they will become larger. And the domains with incorrect direction of polarization will become thinner. Now let's look what happens with the surface charges. So when these domains with correct direction of polarization expanded, we shall have additional exceed of the positive depolarization charge at the low boundary of the samples and the negative at the upper. But in this case, so we have field origin from D, but also we shall have now some depolarization field that will be up-directed. And actually, well, after this result of calculation and also can be discussed, but it take some time, but you see this oppositely directed depolarization fields that do not exist if the average depolarization field do not exist if the domain are equally populated. But when we create this non-equal population of up-down oriented domain, we create this depolarization field that is oppositely directed. And this oppositely directed field win with respect to D. This is the result of precise calculation inside of the Kittel model. And finally, well, we obtain the formula, so that contains this intrinsic contribution just because of the polarization of P, and contribution because of the motion of domain walls. And this contribution win because the thickness of the film is higher than the domain period, and it gives us the oppositely directed average polarization inside of the domain structure. But I would like to stress again that total capacitance of the system will stay always positive. But what is fun is that we have part of the system when D is opposite to E. And actually, the question, so what? And one should propose some effects which is based on this. Well, one effect that I already told is construction of this passive amplifier, which is still under discussion. But I would like to tell that there is some very important impact of this negative capacitance to the dynamics of the domain walls. So the and actually it will be active in terahertz regime. So actually what happens? Let's assume it's just some Gedanken experiment, because one can not do such experiment at terahertz region, but let's assume that we we applied some periodic time-dependent external electric field, and let's see what will happen with domain structure, how it will respond on the periodically applied field. Actually, what will happen if the domain structure has some stiffness? Because if we change the thickness of the up and down oriented domain, immediately it creates a depolarization field that want to put the period down. So in principle, this is the electrostatic, purely electrostatic, that makes the stiffness of the domain wall structure. Basing on the simple harmonic oscillator equation, when chi is the stiffness, you see you have here only parameters. We have no material. I mean, we have material parameters, but nothing more. So this is purely electrostatic. That always would like to have the equal periodicity, and if we go out, we create the restorative force due to appearing of the domain field. So we introduce the mass of the domain walls. We introduce also the damping coefficients. This is the question of separate discussion. But finally, such harmonic oscillator equation give us the new mode of oscillations. Of it's like optical mode, because they are in phase, the oscillations of the domain walls. They give us some mode of oscillations of domain walls, and calculations show that it looks like usual modes. We can calculate the resonance frequency. We can calculate actually all of the responses on the type-dependent perturbation. And finally, here this, I mean, the result, we indeed have the resonance in the sub-terahertz and near-terahertz region. The frequency, what is important, it depends on the thickness that permits us also to, so this is the resonance frequency. Here is a function of thickness. So is also the variation of the thickness of the domain of the ferroelectric width permits us to tune. Yeah, but why? So what? Why it is? Actually, this everybody quite easy accepts this. But what is the relation with negative capacitance? Actually, the relation is simple. So this formula for the harmonic oscillations permit us also to calculate the frequency dependence of the dielectric constant, and this is the most important parameter that drives the system. So as I told again that the static value is negative because E is directed opposite to D. But of course, at high frequencies, when the motion of domain walls becomes frozen, we should go to the positive regime. So we go to through the point, so-called zero dielectric near epsilon zero point. And this is point important because this is the point of the resonance. So this is the same explication as I told you in terms of stiffness, but just in the term of the dielectric constant. Everybody who working with spectroscopy knows that if dielectric constants cross zero, we should have some resonance phenomena. So even the phenomena somehow similar to the infrared oscillation of the molecules, but still it is not the case because in the case of infrared oscillations, we have only small frequency region where dielectric constant is negative, dynamical region. But in our case, we have the static negative dielectric constant. Situation is more similar to what we know from the plasmonics. So this is a typical textbook explication of the plasmonic resonance when in metal, dielectric constant, but here, of course, in ultra UV region, cross the zero, we have the plasmon resonance. Actually, what we have now with domains, we have this plasma resonance. This is the same thing as in metal, because in metal, plasma resonance is just because the traveling cause a charge from the upper surface to the lower, and it's purely electrostatic. In our case, also, we have the alternation on the charge, but now it's depolarization charge from the upper to the lower surface. So it's exactly the same phenomena. It's exactly as in metal. It happens because of the negative dielectric constants as a low frequency region. Well, after in principle one can play with different thickness of the superlattices, one can construct different metamaterials and make some engineering of the epsilon dependent of the dielectric constant for such such a system. But finally, how one should observe this somehow. For me, the most suitable for the moment for the moment way to observe is the terahertz optics, because the dielectric constant is entered to the refractive index like this, and one should of course find the suitable geometry to observe this phenomenon. So for instance, we send the some beam, we see the we see the reflection for the film, and it should be P geometry to have the component which is perpendicular to the layer. So if we are doing this near Brewster angle, this type of experiment, actually we can calculate the reflectance of the system. It's better that I will show you the result. And indeed, the delta R here is abstracted, the contribution of substrates, give us this Lorentzian type of spike. That is exactly the resonance phenomena, and in principle, it should be very large. It should be very large. It's, you see delta R over R is something 0.5. It's a very high value, and contemporary method of infrared spectroscopy, they allow us to see the molecules at the surface. So for me, it should be not problem really to, well, there are of course some another problems, but for me, it's completely doable. So this is a plot of this resonance, Lorentzian resonance as function of angle of incidence. So everything occurs near Brewster angle, and we have some resonance at the frequency of the resonance that I show. Finally, it would be, again, even more interesting to have the terahertz ellipsometry, because in this case, you can also measure the phase of the reflected wave. And what is interesting, so we go from the negative, so this is, we can go by frequency or the same by angle. So we go from the negative to positive phase. And after we change this as function, so this is by a black is the resonance point, so we change this phase over pi. And in this case, in the ellipsometry, we should observe so-called topological black points, so when the reflection will be exactly equal to zero, because there we go around this point and we see the phase of reflective wave, we should have really 2 pi to pi singularity. And possibly I will finish here. My time is expired, and for me also this nice structures that Paul observed and now many people observe, it's very nice way to have such type of the terahertz like plasmonics and make observe the interaction of this terahertz plasmon created by domain structure with some another plasmon created by the metal. So I see in principle some ways of development of metamaterials which is based, can be based on such an effect. So possibly I will finish at this point, and thank you very much for your attention.